Hey hatchlings, it's Dragonfeather, and welcome back to the channel, and today is the very first episode of Witch to Watch, and I have a very special guest here. Thank you for joining us, Juniper Rose. My hood just fell off for you, My hood fell for you. It's true. This is Juniper Rose, and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hi, hello, how doing?
Hello, hi, how doing?
I mean, we're kind of the same person a little bit, just a little bit.
It's so trippy though.
It's really trippy.
It's trippy. And then like our other fatal flaws, tangents, which we literally just went on.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and your practice.
For me, my magical name that I go by is Juniper Rose, and that is also my channel name, just to make it simple. I focus on a lot of different things, actually. I started out with crystals and divination, just to kind of ease myself into the craft, and because they were very interesting to me. So they're definitely still a huge part of my craft. I also practice dance magic, and that's definitely something that I absolutely love. There's not a whole lot of information out there on dance magic. I've just kind of been learning as I go along.
Dance has just always been such a huge part of my life, and being able to learn how to incorporate that into my craft has been a huge thing. You saw me last night, I was dancing all over the kitchen.
Oh, yeah.
For me, it's just like when a moment happens where I just want to dance and I just kind of go into a trance, and it happens when it happens. Like I don't plan it. It just
Absolutely.
Happens. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's such a powerful way for me to not only connect my mind, my body, and my spirit, but it's very healing and therapeutic for me. Just being able to explore what dance magic is for myself has been a really cool experience.
It's really fascinating to me too.
There haven't been a lot of resources on specifically dance magic, so my journey as of late has literally just been figuring out how witchcraft and dance correlate together to
Absolutely.
Create dance magic, and being able to create that for myself and apply my knowledge of dance and my knowledge of witchcraft, which are both ever growing in my opinion, into this craft has been such a powerful thing for me.
And I also have been learning about how to work more with dragons. I definitely do not call myself a draconic witch, but that is something that I am incorporating into my practice. I also have been studying fey magic, fairy magic. So far with that, I'm just mostly in the research phase, but I love it as well. I've definitely had quite a few experiences with the fae in my life. Getting to go back and learn more about that has been fascinating for me. That kind of coincides with the second question, which is, what type of witch do you identify as? Definitely eclectic, because I have a whole bunch of different paths that I've, or practices that I've kind of just taken bits and pieces of and put into my own practice. One other thing that definitely does interest me is Celtic witchcraft, because that is definitely pretty much almost all of my heritage. I have been practicing for about a year and a half now, so I'm definitely still a newbie witch out there, but you know, you gotta start somewhere, right?
Hatchling Clan has actually really helped me progress so much this past year in my studying, and I don't think I would be this far along without it, so.
Oh, same.
Thank you. You're welcome!
Juniper Rose is actually one of the leaders of the Hatchling Clan, and she has her own YouTube channel that I absolutely enjoy. I am definitely subscribed.
Thank you.
If you are not subscribed, you should subscribe. The link's down below.
I started this channel because I had been wanting to start a YouTube channel for a while, but I wasn't entirely sure what I wanted to do for my channel. Wanted it to be something unique, something that's not quite as mainstream as like a beauty channel. Started practicing my craft, and I was like, you know what, like, yeah, there's some witchy YouTubers out there, but I've definitely found that YouTube is a great resource for people who want to learn more about what people practice and learn more about other people's experiences with their craft. Some people that might just not have access to books to be able to learn, and so YouTube is a great resource to go to find you know, what people's experiences have been so far. And I wanted to share my experience with you guys because I find this path so empowering for me, and it's helped me connect with myself in ways that I never imagined. It's helped me, I feel, become a better person. It's helped me be more comfortable in my skin. It's helped me have more self-value and self-worth, and I think that's such an important thing, especially in this day and age where, you know, you're told what to do, you're told how to look. You know, you have the ability to say no to that. You have the ability to say, I'm going to be me. I'm just here to share my experiences with you and what I have learned personally. My path is not your path. My path is not Azura's path, or my path is not Harmony Nice's path. You know what I mean? Like, we all have a different path to follow, and I'm just here to share my experiences and my path.
Zara, why do you make these questions so hard? Why?
Honestly, all of my videos have been really fun for me to film, and it's hard for me to pick a favorite. My All About In Bulk video was one of my favorites to film and edit. It was a little tipsy. That wasn't intentional, but it's been a huge hit, and people have really liked it. What I liked about that experience is that I was just able to let go of some of my inhibitions and be a bit crazy, you know? It was just fun. I really enjoyed filming my room and altar tour. It was just something different that I hadn't done before, and I was able to use a lot of cool camera effects with like the reverse smoke from my altar. One of my earlier videos, it was Witchy Wonders episode 4, and that was all about crystals. I love crystals so much, and I was just really excited to get on there and share what I knew about crystals, my experiences with them, with you guys. My most two recent videos are, I'd have to say, my next favorites. So the Where the Hell Have I Been Chatty Get Ready With Me video, where I just sat and chatted with you guys about how my life has been lately, my updates in terms of my recent move to Arizona. It was definitely different because, you know, it kind of forced me to come on to the camera without my face on. And my most recent video was the Hanging with Hatchlings episode 1 part 2. Part 1 is over on Azura Dragonfeather's channel, but I definitely say that's in my top 5 because it was the first time that I had done any sort of a vlogging type of video, and I was hanging out with hatchlings. I mean, how is that not fun? What was really funny about when we all met, it was just interesting because we felt like we had met in person before, even though we hadn't. Like, we've just been online friends, you know, helping run the Hatchling Clan. We got together in person and everything just felt so natural. It was just like seeing one of your really good friends that you might not have seen in a couple of years. I'm so glad that I filmed that vlog because I'm gonna have that memory to look back on for the rest of my life.
How long have you been dancing?
I started dancing when I was 4.
Oh wow!
And I did Scottish Highland dancing until I was 13, and then after that I started studying ballet and modern and contemporary. And
so literally, yeah. Dance has kind of been like one of the main passions of your life. So yeah, it's really cool too because she also runs the Dance Magic chat room in the Hatchling Clan. If you're interested in learning more about it, I'm over there as well. I like to focus on hula hoop dancing in my craft, but she focuses on completely, entirely different dancing in her craft. So it's really cool diversity, and there's a lot of people over there that are exploring it as well in case that's something that you're interested in.
For me, what magic is, just the bare bones of it, is working with the energies around you and your own personal will and intent. Magic is basically taking your intent and infusing it with the energies around you in order to release it into the universe, and, you know, in hopes that that will manifest what you desire and that the universe will respond. And so the biggest thing for me is that magic and witchcraft has been something for me to get to know myself better, for me to feel more empowered as an individual, for me to just say fuck it to following society's rules and expectations of me, and to just go my own way. I'm a lot more confident in myself, and I've learned to value myself more. and I've learned to love myself more. And one of my biggest personal beliefs is that before you can really truly love anybody else, you have to be able to love yourself first. So far with my path, there's been nothing but positive changes that I've seen in my life and in my mentality. So I think my favorite memory was, it was actually when I created my own inner realm. It was before Azura had released that as a hatchling clan challenge. It was quite some time before that. I just was kind of sad about some things that were going on in my life, and I wanted to create a space in my mind and just kind of get away from it. And so that's how I wound up creating my own inner realm. And in that same meditation, that's actually how I met my Monte. That was definitely a pivotal point in my practice. It wasn't anything special that I was doing. It was just purely me meditating and visualizing. But probably wouldn't have met my Monte the way that I did without that. And I hold that memory and I hold that experience really close to my heart.
Tell us a little bit about fairies with you.
Fairies.
How do fairies relate to you?
Well, they follow me everywhere.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Are you a fairy?
Yeah. Yeah, actually I am.
You're like, low-key fairy.
Yeah. One of the things that I recently, I guess, discovered, I kind of already knew, to be honest, but it was confirmed to me a few months after I started practicing, and it was confirmed to me through meditational practices that I was having with my guardians and guides. And it was something that I was questioning just because of how I was as a child. You know, like, fairies literally were my entire existence. It was like fairies and dance, quite literally.
They go together so well, though.
They really do, though. Like,
and dancing is a really great offering for fairies.
It's an amazing offering for the fae. I literally believed that I was a fairy when I was a kid. It was such a huge part of my life, and I had so many experiences with the fae. You know, it's just kind of been a part of me. And that meditation where I discovered I was fae-kin, it just kind of confirmed something that I already knew, but I was kind of doubting myself initially.
Oh, I totally,
you know, because it's kind of a weird thing to realize that in a past life you were something other than a human. Like, if you believe in reincarnation, I do believe in reincarnation.
Same.
And discovering that I was a fairy in at least one past life, I don't know how many, explains a lot of things.
A lot of things have been explained.
A lot of things about me, to be honest. Fairies have always been around me. Why I've been so fascinated with them, it's just because that's who I am.
Oh yeah.
So.
And especially, like, fairies, a lot of the legends come from, like, our heritage too. And so that's why, like, I mean, I am more connected to dragons than I am fairies, but recently I've been, you know, wanting to work with the fae more, and that's why I'm, like, really excited to have Juniper on the first episode of Witch to Watch, because of her connection to fairies. And I mean, look at this face. She totally looks like a fairy. So, can you see her wings? They're, like, right here. A little bit. And she's like, ha 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 ha.
In terms of items, definitely crystals. I use crystals all the time, every day. Even if I'm not doing anything particularly witchy that day, I'll grab a few crystals for comfort or for anything that I'm experiencing. You know, for example, like, if I need grounding one particular day, then I will grab a grounding crystal. If I need something to help calm me down and soothe me, if I'm having anxiety or if I'm nervous about something, I'll grab crystals to help with anxiety. I use my tarot cards a lot. I love to do readings for people and myself. When I'm actually practicing and doing spells, I feel like the tool that I use the most is my athame. And I'll use that to call in the corners for my circle, direct energy, and to cast my circle with. I also love my cauldron. It's just basically an old ceramic candle holder, but it works. I love burning things.
Is there anything else you'd like to share about your practice or your craft?
I don't know. I've got a lot of stories if you want to hear any.
Please share.
About the fae.
Oh yeah, I would love to.
Yeah.
I'm here for this.
I'm so here for this. I was born ready, bitches.
I'm ready. Well, friends, I'm ready.
It affects my everyday life more mentally than physically, I feel. I feel like it's definitely helped me come into the person that I am today. It's helped me be more confident in my everyday mundane life as well as in my practice. And that's the hugest difference that I've noticed. And again, before, like I was saying, I almost always have some kind of crystal on me. Small things that I'll do every day that I didn't used to do. Still definitely a work in progress to be able to incorporate more of my practice into my everyday life, make certain things in my practice more of a daily habit, but you know, we'll get there eventually. Baby steps.
When I was a kid, I basically had a lot of tea parties with the fairies, if that makes any
sense. That's so cute!
I had these little like doll-sized tea sets that were just really, really cute and tiny, and I would fill them up with like little bits of like water, and I'd get like little lavender petals from our garden and like make little lavender tea things out of it.
Oh, that's so cute!
And I would go sit out in the backyard and just essentially just kind of have a tea party with the fae, and it was a really special thing for me, and it was something that I kind of did regularly, you know? It's just kind of one of those natural witchy things you do mm-hmm. as a kid. Oftentimes, the next morning, there would be a fairy ring.
That's so crazy!
Right where we had the tea party, but...
So you had these tea parties, like, outside, I'm assuming?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's so whimsical.
Yeah. And they would just come visit and butter around, I guess.
I think the biggest thing for me when I was starting out was that I was really overwhelmed with all of the information and all that there is to learn about witchcraft. I was interested in a lot of it. I didn't really know where to start. For a while, it was just really overwhelming. I kind of felt like I was just barely treading water. I guess that's also the advice that I would give to brand new witchlings is yes, starting this path can be very overwhelming. There's a huge shift in mindset between being told what to do in a organized religious aspect or environment and then just being dumped into this completely new way of learning where you need to do your own research and figure things out for yourself and find out your own personal truths. Just start with one thing at a time. You know, if you're interested in crystals, start with crystals.
Actually, what's really interesting is not too long after I started practicing, this was not too long before I started practicing.
Oh wow.
I had a crazy dream one night. There was like this huge like house party going on, and it was like this giant house with like this pool. In the garden, like there were a bunch of fae and fairies having a tea party. And it was like on this like long, beautiful glass table. And it was really funny because I guess the house in the dream was mine, because like in the dream, like even though it doesn't look like your house, yeah, yeah. You know it's your house. But these fae had basically brought out like all of my belongings and like all of my teacups, because I collect antique teacups.
Literally, they're adorable.
I love them. And like all of my vintage books and just like all of the pretty things for my room to decorate for this tea party. And I was sitting next to, I guess, it was like the queen,
like a fairy queen?
Yeah, it was a fairy queen. I was sitting next to her and she was just kind of staring at me inquisitively.
Inquisitively.
I was looking for the right word to say. Just pretty much the whole time. And I remember just in this dream being like kind of confused as to what was going on.
Definitely.
And then like when the tea party ended, you know, I was like, well, I've got to take all my things back into my room, because somehow like I was having anxiety over my things being everywhere, I guess.
In your dream, yeah.
In my dream. And so I was trying to take all these things back into the house, you know, so that they would be safe, I guess. And the fairies just kept bringing them right back out. And
oh my goodness.
And they kept asking me to come with them. Come back with us. Come with us. And I was like, no, I'm sorry, I can't. Like, I have my life here. I have to stay here. I don't quite remember what the fairy queen had said, but it was something really interesting. I wrote a blog about it in the Hatchling Clan, like,
oh, I'll link it down below.
It was a tea party with the fae, is this story for you guys. It was a really interesting dream because
I didn't really think much of it at the time because it was before I had started practicing. But after I'd started practicing and I remembered that dream and was just kind of thinking about it more and more, there was a lot of symbolism in there, and it just kind of got me thinking, like, what would have happened if I actually had said yes?
Oh yeah, that's really scary to think about a little.
It's scary, but it's also fascinating.
It's very fascinating.
And
thrilling indeed.
I think it was a little bit of foreshadowing into me starting my path and
oh, okay.
reconnecting with my inner child and my fae self.
I
think that dream just kind of started to reawaken that in me. So
is connecting with your inner child a huge part of your craft?
Oh, most definitely.
Oh, yeah, definitely same.
Most definitely. Connecting with my inner child basically guided me to back to my core.
Yeah.
Like what I believe,
like
in my
who
core
you are.
And who I am.
Yeah.
And that's what basically led me to my path in witchcraft. My inner child led me.
I know that a few people know this already if you stalk me on the Hatchling Clan, but not everybody knows it, so I'm going to tell you. It is our little secret. Wow. One thing that not very many people know about me is that I am Faken. I believe that I was a fairy in one of my past lives. It definitely makes a lot of sense for me, and it's something that I found out through meditating and kind of reflecting back on my life, this one right here, as to what my mannerisms are and have been and just who I am. And it was really interesting to learn more about why I am the way that I am, like why I love dancing so much, why I hate gold, why I stop watch batteries if I wear them for more than 2 weeks, why I interfere with technology so much. Like that's, I mean, I know that a lot of my issues with technology are user error, but sometimes it just doesn't work.
I think that our inner children are very underrated because you're just expected to be an adult, like all the time, every day. Yet, you know, being an adult is boring. I hate adulting,
100%
yeah. But like, yeah, in this society, we're basically taught to repress and block our inner children, and there's nothing wrong with letting your inner child out and letting your inner child guide you, because they're not just innocent, crazy little nutheads, but they're very wise. They're they're what will lead you to your true self.
Because it's like who we are at our most natural, pure, unlike tampered with.
It's
stages.
Who we, it's our raw selves that's been untainted by society and by life. It's our pure and rawest selves.
And that's why it's such a huge thing in my craft too, is getting in touch with myself, especially with tiny craft and stuff like that, just because I 100% am not happy when I'm not in some sort of a childlike wondering mindset. Like having that childlike wonder helps me be a happier person, you know what I mean?
Oh, I know exactly
what
you mean.
It's like absolutely like a part of like how I exist.
literally me.
Those are some really fascinating stories. I absolutely loved that. If you want to go check her out, she also runs the Fairy Magic Chat Room and the Hatchling Clan if you are interested in learning more about the Fae. Where can people find you on the internets?
All over the fucking place. I'm very grateful that I get to be on the first episode of Witch to Watch, and I cannot wait to see it.
All of her information and her blog posts that we mentioned and covered in this video will be linked down below for you. Really easy peasy, so you can go ahead and click on that. And thank you so much for watching episode 1 of Witch to Watch. This is the series where I cover different types of witches, both young, both old, both new, and well known within the community, to kind of showcase and shed some light on the magic of our community. So thank you so much for joining the first episode. I'm so excited.
Thank you.
I will see you guys in the next episode of Witch to Watch for episode 2. But until next time, stay geeky, cheeky, and freaky! Little hatchlings. Oh my goodness.
And for now, the witch is out.
Bye! Bye.
Thumbnail moment!
Okay.
In your words, what does magic mean to you? In my words.
just, I can't stop with the faces.
I like squirrels and coffee. Also, I have to pee. I guess this switches out. Okay, bye. It's funny that you think that I'm different when we're both